The unthinkable has happened. A blinding flash, a thunderous roar, and a towering mushroom cloud rise as the world and you change in an instant. So what really happens to your body during a nuclear explosion? Brace yourself. The reality of what comes next is devastating. A 100 kiloton nuclear weapon has just detonated over the city. The area around Ground Zero isn't damaged, it's erased. And as the shockwave races outward, you're about to feel what that level of destruction truly means. For the scale, the little boy bomb dropped on Hiroshima was roughly 15 kilotons, and Fat Man over Nagasaki was about 21. What you're in the path of now is nearly 5 times greater than the only nuclear weapons ever used in war. If you're standing directly at Ground Zero, the point directly beneath the detonation, you are not just witnessing the event, you are part of it. If the bomb is detonated as an airburst, the superheated plasma ball will instantly expand and consume the area below. The temperature inside this initial fireball is incomprehensible. It's caused by the fission and fusion reactions. The estimated internal temperature of a nuclear explosion is over 100 million degrees Celsius. That is hotter than the core of the sun, which is only about 15 million degrees Celsius. At these temperatures, the human body stops functioning as an organic structure. Its mass is instantly transformed into a rapidly expanding gas as molecular bonds break apart in a fraction of a second. The water that makes up about 60% of your body flashes into superheated steam. Your calcium-rich bones, skin, and organs are stripped away by the heat, leaving behind a darkened shadow at best. More often, nothing at all. Anyone caught inside of this fireball isn't merely burned or destroyed, they are reduced to their basic elements. In other words, you are vaporized. But even if this initial thermal blast somehow missed a tiny fraction of your body, the ensuing shockwave would finish the destruction. The detonation unleashes a massive supersonic compression front known as the peak overpressure wave, a sudden, violent increase in atmospheric pressure triggered by the nuclear fireball's rapid expansion. It races outward at incredible speed, crushing everything in its path. The pressure on your body would be like having the weight of an entire 18-wheeler concentrated on every single square inch of your skin. Your soft tissues, including the lungs and the spleen, would be instantly liquefied. Your bones would shatter into hundreds of minute fragments hurled outward by a shockwave traveling faster than the speed of sound. Even concrete structures would crumble into dust, so your body would offer absolutely no resistance. At Ground Zero, you are not injured. You are ripped apart atom by atom. There is no suffering, only instantaneous absolute annihilation. Move out from Ground Zero by 1,000 feet, roughly the length of 3 football fields, and the situation shifts from immediate vaporization to something arguably even more horrific, near instantaneous death. And for a brief moment, you would see exactly what's about to end your life. At this distance, the sequence of destruction is dictated by basic physics, the speed of light versus the speed of sound. This creates a brief, agonizing window of awareness, giving you just enough time to register the blinding flash before the forces of destruction catch up. The first thing to hit you is the thermal pulse, a massive burst of energy and light. The instant the blast occurs, you'll see a flash brighter than 1,000 suns. Even if you aren't looking directly at it, the intensity of the light scattering off the atmosphere is enough to penetrate your eyelids. It only lasts for a tiny fraction of a second, but it packs a catastrophic dose of radiant energy. Your eye focuses this immediate burst of energy directly onto the delicate tissue of your retina. The concentrated thermal light sears it instantly, burning the rods and cones and effectively fusing them together. The damage is so severe, it causes flash blindness and almost certainly permanent total blindness. But you'll have more than a fraction of a second to understand it before the fireball reaches you. The thermal energy is so intense that it can even superheat the optic nerve and the fluid inside of the eyeball itself, causing the eye to explode. At 1,000 feet away from Ground Zero, the energy is powerful enough to instantly ignite anything flammable. Your clothing would flash vaporize and combust immediately. The air would superheat and cause immediate third-degree burns across 100% of your exposed skin. The water in your skin boils so quickly that it creates tiny steam explosions inside of your pores, ripping tissue apart. Your skin would cook, sloughing off as the muscle beneath it is destroyed. The surface of your body could be carbonized in a split second, reduced to a layer of brittle blackened char. But then, the peak overpressure wave arrives, moving at supersonic speed. The force would be equivalent to several thousand tons pressing down on you. The extreme pressure difference between the atmosphere and the inside of your body causes catastrophic failure of every air-filled organ. Your eardrums would be pulverized. The air sacs in your lungs would tear apart, leading to massive internal hemorrhaging and death by asphyxiation. Your skull would shatter, your chest cavity would collapse, and your internal organs would be turned into an unrecognizable pulped mass. and it's all over within a second. Half a mile out lies the edge of the severe damage zone. At this distance, the horror is no longer instantaneous annihilation, but a chaotic, violent death, usually caused by the world collapsing around you. The blast ensures total structural failure. Few, if any, buildings are expected to be structurally sound or even standing in the severe damage zone. The overpressure wave slams into the windward side of a structure, hitting it with a sudden massive compressive load that overwhelms its failure point in an instant. Walls shear, supports buckle, and the entire building collapses in a violent, pancaking cascade. If you were inside, your body would suffer crushing injuries from falling debris, resulting in severe blunt trauma. The aftermath transforms the area into a graveyard. Streets would be choked with rubble several stories. Those who somehow survive face a deadly barrage of primary and secondary blast injuries. The primary blast injury is the shockwave slamming into the body. Your eardrums would rupture instantly, a classic blast injury known as tympanic membrane perforation. And the thermal pulse is still a death sentence at this distance. While it no longer carbonizes you on the spot, the radiation intensity is enough to cause second and third degree flash burns across every inch of your exposed skin. It's a dose of heat that instantly coagulates proteins, charring the skin and causing the body to go into shock. Even if every other injury were survivable, the infection that follows would not be. The blast acts like a massive invisible slingshot, transforming everyday objects into deadly projectiles. Broken window glass become lethal shards, and concrete fragments, wood splinters, and metal debris are thrown outward at high speed. Flying shrapnel would tear into you, causing deep penetrating wounds and severe lacerations, any one of which could be fatal if it struck a vital organ. And if you're out in the open, the force of the blast would hurl you off of your feet. You would be slammed into the ground with enough force to cause massive impact injuries. And at this distance, you are guaranteed to be bombarded by a lethal dose of radiation from the torrent of high-energy gamma rays and neutrons released in the first minute after the blast. The exposure here reaches into the thousands of rads. A whole-body dose of more than 1,000 rads means a horrific death from acute radiation syndrome, not within weeks and months, but days or even hours. Sure, you might survive the physical destruction if you were hiding out in subterranean garages or subway tunnels, but even reaching medical help would mean overcoming impossible odds. Fighting through critical injuries, lethal radiation exposure, and a post-apocalyptic landscape, any rapid response is unrealistic. In practical terms, survival at half a mile is statistically non-existent. At 1 mile out, you'd be in the moderate damage zone. Here, survival becomes possible, but it is gonna be agonizing. The instant, brutal finality of Ground Zero is replaced by overwhelming human suffering, collapsing infrastructure, and the slow, invisible poison of radiation. Though the blast wave hasn't hit yet, the thermal pulse still travels at the speed of light. The heat intensity is enough to cause widespread, horrific burns through direct line-of-sight exposure, and the amount of radiant energy is enough to cause third-degree burns. This means the destruction of the entire epidermis and underlying subcutaneous fat and muscle. The burns can destroy your nerve endings, leaving patches of blackened or charred tissue that are disturbingly painless. These massive thermal injuries trigger immediate burn shock, causing fluid loss and dangerous electrolyte imbalances. The sudden loss of the skin barrier, coupled with the sheer number of victims, means the moderate damage zone survivors represent the largest group of casualties. But the number of patients would instantly overwhelm all available hospitals and burn units. So getting the medical attention you desperately need becomes increasingly difficult. Even dark clothing can absorb enough thermal energy to transfer it to the skin, causing severe localized flesh burns where the fabric touches the body. When the supersonic shockwave arrives, the pressures are still devastating. Sturdier buildings, those reinforced with concrete and steel-framed high-rises, will stay standing, but they'll suffer immense structural stress. This would cause the complete failure of non-load-bearing walls and windows. However, lighter commercial and multi-unit residential buildings could become structurally unstable, and many typical wood frame houses will be destroyed completely. So, the risk of being crushed or impaled by debris is still very much a real threat. The force from the high winds from the shockwave will still overturn cars, rip small trees out of the ground, and snap telephone and light poles. This structural violence turns the streets into a war zone with rubble, fires, and overturned vehicles blocking every route. Evacuation becomes difficult, often impossible, without heavy equipment. And that means help will take time to reach you. If your injuries are severe, that delay may be enough to kill you. Even if you survive the burns and the collapsing buildings, you're still within the range of a potentially lethal radiation dose. Anyone exposed in the open would absorb a significant amount of radiation, roughly 300 rads. That is still a severe exposure level, guaranteed to cause acute radiation syndrome. Almost every person exposed to this would become ill within hours, showing signs of severe nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea as the radiation destroys the cells in the gastrointestinal tract and the bone marrow. Without specialized treatment or intensive supportive care, about half of those exposed to this dose would die over the following weeks or months, mainly from infections caused by the collapse of white blood cell production and internal hemorrhaging. And this initial exposure is only the beginning. It's made worse by secondary hazards, including elevated radiation levels from short-lived gamma-emitting fallout settling back to Earth. The overwhelming destruction guarantees immediate and widespread infrastructure failure. Broken water, gas, electrical, and communication lines are expected across the entire moderate damage zone. Ruptured gas lines will fuel raging fires that will spread throughout the damaged debris-filled structures. If you are within a protective structure and survive the shockwave and the radiation, you might still be burnt alive. If you were 5 miles away, the immediate threat shifts from total structural collapse to mass casualties driven by secondary effects and thermal pulse. The destructive forces are more dispersed here. The shockwave rebounds off of buildings, terrain, and even the atmosphere, creating unpredictable pockets of localized destruction that can strike with little warning. The first and fastest effect that reaches you is the overwhelming light caused by the explosion. Even at 5 miles away, the brilliant flash of light could cause temporary blindness to anyone outdoors. The light is so intense that it momentarily bleaches the light-sensitive chemicals in the retina's photoreceptors. It is big enough to temporarily overload the system, causing a complete washout of vision. Flash blindness can happen even if the victim is not looking in the direction of the detonation, as the light scatters and reflects off atmospheric particles and cloud cover. This effect can last several seconds to minutes. The intensity of the thermal radiation is still enough to inflict widespread severe burns. First-degree burns can reach beyond 5 miles from the blast site, depending on the weather. Second-degree burns are the major risk at this distance, causing agonizing pain, severe blistering, and requiring extensive medical care. If you are outside and facing the blast at the moment of the detonation and you don't immediately seek shelter, you can still sustain severe burns at this distance. When the slower shockwave finally arrives, the peak overpressure is significantly lower. The primary human threat is no longer a crushing force, but secondary injuries from flying debris. The blast has enough force to create widespread hazardous damage. The long-term effects on your body if you survive the initial blast and the thermal pulse are dominated by radioactive fallout and the onset of radiation sickness. For those who absorb a high but not immediately fatal dose of radiation, either from the initial burst or from fallout, hematopoietic syndrome can develop. Radiation targets the rapidly dividing cells in the bone marrow, causing a collapse in blood cell production. Without white blood cells, survivors become incredibly vulnerable to infection. And without platelets, they suffer massive uncontrollable hemorrhaging. Death often occurs weeks after exposure, generally from systemic infection or blood loss. Decades after exposure, the most insidious long-term effects appear as cancer and chronic diseases due to the initial DNA damage. The most notorious effect is a massive spike in thyroid cancer. Beyond the thyroid, high-energy particles damage DNA throughout the body, causing mutations that trigger uncontrolled cell division and lead to a wide range of cancers. Studies show a significant rise in leukemia beginning just 2 to 5 years after exposure, followed by increased rates of solid cancers such as lung, breast, and colon cancer. These can continue to plague survivors for 50 years or more. The possibility of genetic mutation and birth defects being passed down to subsequent generations is also a real possibility. Beyond cancer, radiation accelerates the aging process and causes other chronic illnesses in your body. Damage to the lymphatic system leads to immune system suppression, leaving you vulnerable to recurring infection and chronic inflammatory diseases for the rest of your life. Recent studies of atomic bomb survivors show that even non-lethal radiation doses can dramatically increase the risk of cardiovascular disease, stroke, and chronic kidney disease decades later. Radiation triggers long-lasting inflammation and scarring in blood vessels, accelerating the hardening and narrowing of arteries far beyond normal aging. In the end, survival isn't the end of the story, it is just the beginning of a lifelong struggle your body was never built to endure. Now watch, can you survive a nuclear winter? Or check out this video instead.